Hi, good morning and welcome to this meditation. Today is the 5th of July, of course, and this meditation was supposed to be for Sunday, last Sunday, the 3rd, but it's going to be on our channel today, on the 7th. Last weekend, the 2nd and the 3rd, we had a wedding on Saturday and by the sea. And on Sunday, we had a special breakfast at the church, and we invited tourists and people from our church to come and enjoy a time of fellowship around the table, eating croissant and pain au chocolat, which they call chocolatina here, the chocolate bread, as we call it. It was a wonderful time of fellowship as we sang to the Lord, ate croissants and listen to his word. So I had a special meditation on the wedding supper of the Lamb, thinking of what we were doing last weekend, on the 2nd and the 3rd of July. And then I read a Revelation chapter, in Revelation chapter 19, verse 6 to 8. Then I heard what sounded like a great multitude, like the roar of rushing waters and like loud peals of thunder shouting, "Hallelujah, for our Lord God Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory, for the wedding of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready. Fine linen, bright and clean, was given her to wear." And then John is going to explain in verse 8 what this fine linen, bright and clean, means. Fine linen stands for the righteous acts of God's holy people. It's the righteousness of God in us. And you see that the church in the book of Revelation is actually wearing this fine linen, bright and clean. And then because they are covered with God's righteousness. So, what was the purpose of God for us from eternity? We see in the book of Genesis, as we see in the book of Revelation, that there is a tree. The tree of life is in the book of Genesis, and it's all we are going to find it in the book of Revelation as well. But when man was put in the garden, there were two trees and he could eat from these two trees. The first tree was the tree of the knowledge of evil and good. And God told man not to eat from that tree, because the day they ate, they would die, certainly die, as the text says. But they could actually eat from the tree of life. But as we read the book of Genesis, we realize that they never ate from the tree of life. The serpent tempted them to eat from the other tree, and they ate. And the result of it is all over you now, all over us now, all everywhere. We see it as we watch the news. We see it as we watch a movie. As we go out of our houses and flats, we see the results of that fall, the fall of man. But from eternity, God wanted us to be his, to belong to him, to be filled with his glory, to inherit the gifts of the Holy Spirit, the gifts of God's heart. That's what God wanted for us. God wanted us to have fellowship with him and to be filled with his presence and be guided by him. That's what they would have if they had eaten from the tree of life. So we come to a point when we have a choice. Are we going to come to the supper of the Lamb, or are we going to go the devil's way? The devil's way is that we become gods. That's what the temptation was in the garden. But we know very well what happens when we try to take the place of that belongs to God alone. So God is offering us today, as he offered Adam and Eve, and as he offered Abraham, Moses, David, as he offered the disciples by the shores of the Sea of Galilee, the same thing God is offering us. Actually, Jesus said in John chapter 6 that people had to come and eat of him, to feed from his words, but to feed from his life. We tend to think that the goal of preaching the gospel, of the message of the gospel, is to restore a lost paradise. There is no way we can restore a lost paradise. But it's actually to go back to God's first and eternal plan by eating from the tree of life alone and have nothing to do with the other tree. Not trying to control things by our own way, but letting God do it. Every time we fall is because we are eating from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, because we want to have control of every situation. We want to have control of our own lives. But we realize now, we know now that we cannot do so. Our time is so short. There is this fragility in us. We are going to die. We cannot be here and there and everywhere at the same time. We cannot control anything. We cannot, and we know that. It is frustrating, isn't it? But it is better to trust the one who is, who was, and is to come, the most powerful one who has given us his life, who has come down to us and has offered us the tree, the way to the tree of life. What is this eternal calling that God has given us, that Adam and the first men were trying to find in the tree of the knowledge of evil and good by eating from it? What is that purpose? Of course, we know now that God wants us to be filled with his life, which Jesus called, what Jesus called eternal life, to be filled with eternal life, to have a life that is different from the one that it was given to you by your ancestors, by your parents. That biological life is going to die. Even the psychological one, it's not enough. We need another sort of life. Jesus calls it eternal life. It's the life of God. And the greatest present from this eternal life is called agape, the love of God. And when we have the love of God, we have his hope, his joy, his faith, his gifts, the different gifts, the different fruits of the Holy Spirit in us. So the calling that God has got for us is a one to be his child. And as we come to this feast, as we come to this supper of the Lamb, we come as children of God. Not everyone is a child of God. John says that we have to become a child of God. And it is, as it is written in John chapter 1, it is through believing in Christ Jesus, eternal life, receiving his life in us, and then we will become a child of God. Jesus, as he was talking to Nicodemus, a religious man, a Pharisee, he said that in order for him to enter his kingdom, to enter God's kingdom and the kingdom of the Lamb, he had to be born from above. John himself is going to explain that in his first letter, saying that to be born from above is to be born from God. Because he said that we are born from God, we are born from above. So we are the children of God, and that's why we can come to the supper of the Lamb. Cup of tea will help my throat. That's the only way we can come. It's because we have become children of God. And we are going to read a few verses in the book of Romans chapter 8. The first one is in chapter 8, verse 14. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. Who are the children of God? The children of God are those who are led by the Spirit of God. Those who are led by the Spirit of God, they are the children of God. And in the same book, same chapter, verse 9. My goodness, I'm surrounded by dust here from this book, and they make me cough. The dust, not the books. So in the book of Romans chapter 8 verse 9 it is written that those who don't belong to those who haven't got the Spirit of God, they don't belong to Christ. So to become a child of God is to be filled with God's Spirit and be led by His Spirit. And then in Romans chapter 8 verse 16 says, "For the Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children." That's how we know we are God's children. It's because the Spirit is revealing that to us. The Spirit has shown us the same Spirit by whom we have become a child of God. So this Spirit is testifying to us, is telling our spirit that we are children of God. So that's why you can come. You see that the problem with the fall is that man wants to have that place that belongs to God. But God had already, in His eternal purpose, offered us a place with Him. As we are going to see later, a glory to share in His glory. You don't need to want to become like God. We have God's Spirit in us. And that's much better because we are going to be led by His Spirit. But when you want to take the place of God, you are going to be led by your own flesh, not by the Holy Spirit. And it doesn't work. Have you seen around you what is happening in the world today? It shows that it doesn't work. Listening to the devil's voice and appeal to eat from the other tree is the beginning of the fall. And when something is falling, it keeps on falling forever. Only God can catch the thing that is falling and bring it back to His eternal purpose. Otherwise, we are going to fall forever. The second thing that we have to understand when we come to the tree of life is that we are not just children of God, we are heirs of God as well. As Romans chapter 8 verse 17 says, "Now, if we are children," because in verse 16 he said we were children, "if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in His sufferings in order that we may also share in His glory." You are going to see that's the second part of this verse, the glory. The first part is that we are going to inherit everything that belongs to Christ. We tend to think that to inherit something is to gain some gold, some silver. As someone said, gold in heaven is going to be on the streets. We are going to walk on it. Have you seen a vault full of money following a coffin? No. We are not going to take anything from here. But the greatest treasure we have here is the one we have received from God. We are inheriting the values, the grace, the mercies of God. And that's why we can come to the supper of the Lamb, because we are God's children and because we have inherited everything from Him through Christ. This co with Christ here is very important, because some people even say that Paul invented it. It's like when you put different things like flour, eggs, butter, sugar, local chocolate. We have some wonderful chocolate here. Even some chili, the local Espelette chili from the Basque country. Some people use it in chocolate and cake. So when you have it all together and some yeast and you put it in the oven, you are going to have a cake coming out of it. Not flour. You're not going to be saying, "Oh, I'm eating this wonderful flour. We eat flour." No, you eat a cake once everything is mixed up together. So that's what this core is about. Is in Christ we have become one unity. There is this truth about Christ and us, but also about the believers together when they form a body, the church. So we are inheriting with Christ, together with Christ. Everything that is in Christ, it comes in us when we eat from the tree of life, of course. And then in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 13 says, "Until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ." And that's the goal of this inheritance, is that we are going to be mature people. And we are going to to attain to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. That's very important. That's what growth is. To grow in faith, in the knowledge of Christ, is to attain the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. And it is possible here. We have got eternal life now. It is now that we have eternal life. So this inheritance is an amazing inheritance that God has given us through Jesus Christ. So you can come to the supper of the Lamb because you are God's child. You can also come because he has already declared that you have an inheritance through Jesus Christ, with Jesus Christ. And then the last thing is that you can come because you are partaking in his glory. As Romans chapter 8, verse 17 says, if indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory, we can share in his glory. And that's not the glory we're searching through our own means, by our own means, but by becoming like God, but it's by receiving what God has already prepared for us. It's very interesting to see in the book of Revelation how there are two different groups of people. The first group in chapter 6, when they see the glory of the Lamb, they say, mountains, fall on us. They were hiding in caves as it's written in the book of Isaiah chapter 1. There were three times in the book of Isaiah, it appears in the same chapter, that they were hiding from the manifestation of the glory of the Lamb. But the glory of the Lamb, for those people in chapter 6 of Revelation, they don't see it as a glory. They are afraid of that shining presence of the Lamb. In chapter 7, the same glory appears, and the other group, the second group, they sing, "Worthy is the Lamb." And these are the same people who will be at the supper of the Lamb in chapter 19 of the book of Revelation. They have received God's life. They are his children. They have inherited from him, and they are sharing in his glory. You are a child of God. You have received an inheritance. You are sharing in God's glory now, so you can come to the supper of the Lamb. In First John chapter 3, verses 2-3, and this is my conclusion for this meditation today. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be is not yet made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. So the more you learn about it, the more you will want to be like Christ Jesus. So you're going to purify yourself with the help of the Holy Spirit, of course. The more you approach Christ, the more you want to be like him and to receive his glory, to receive his life, to receive his hope and joy and peace and love, to be filled with his grace. God bless you.